Luciano Garcia teaches English and I didn't say this. I assume that this is what we all want. We will have the second presentation and then we will have some time for questions. Although they are very different papers, somehow they deal with Spain, and so I think it's a good idea. Luciano Garcia teaches English, medieval and early modern literature at the University of Jaén, and very especially comparative literature. He's been teaching comparative literature for quite a few years now. He's been the head of the department for 8 years. For 8 years. And he survived, he lived through it.
Now your turn.
He's now here to tell it.
No,
he lives to tell it. And just to give you a glimpse of the kind of person he is, because like myself, he's new in this association, Luciano is the only person I know who not only speaks fluent English, French, and German, apart from Spanish, but he also speaks Esperanto. Just in case, in the future, none of these languages work. He hopes he will be saved by Esperanto. He's going to tell us a very different story. Spanish, there's a Spanish connection as well, but he's going to tell us about other utopias and how some of Thomas More's ideas in utopia perhaps were implemented or applied practically in some settlements that took place in our region, in Andalusia, and by someone who is quite well known in Spain, Pablo de la Vida, and who played a very important role in Latin America, in Spanish America, as we call it.
Okay, thank you for the presentation. I cannot resist just making a public bubble of my being here very comfortable, very well, and really. Also thanking Eugenio because he has converted us to the Moravian faith. And then I say that it is really something that, similar to heaven, no, in a way. I really, really have felt very well. And something that I have appreciated especially is that this is a very interesting meeting point to compare different sections of our learning, so that as I will refer to later, I have learned some things so we can make interesting connections, is what we're training on. I'm grateful, and I think that has been profitable for that. Well, I would like to start with a preliminary note, because when I wrote the abstract for this paper, I thought that I was going to be highly original, because being myself from La Carolina, one of the towns I am going to mention here, I think that I was the first to explore the relationship between the enlightened minister of Charles III that created the new settlements, as they are usually called, as nuevas poblaciones, and Thomas de Utopia. But of course, there was somebody having working in the Spanish domain, Miguel Avilés Fernández, published in 1985 a short reference article to that. And also, fortunately or unfortunately, Dr. María Amparo López Arandia from the University of Extremadura had published as late as last year, in a conference in Alcalá de Henares. Another paper that fortunately has been published is very clear. As you can see, it is En busca de la utopía en la España de la Ilustración, el proyecto de las nuevas poblaciones de Sierra Morena. So I have profited of them, but I have tried to enlarge as well. Well, I would like to start by introducing a little bit the historical context. In 1667, King Charles III of Spain, you can see there, decreed the foundation of a series of settlements along the Camino Real, the King's Highway, between Madrid and Cádiz. The Camino Real was the peninsular stretch, but this portion was the peninsular stretch of the route of the Indies, which allowed the communication of the court with the main ports for the colonial enterprise of Hispano America. And then you have Charles the Third there, and a little bit of introduction of what it means the Camino Real and those settlements as they were. This is in the route, in the what today is the highway I-4 or Autovía de Madrid-Cádiz, and the result of that is a string of towns and villages along the highway scattered through the provinces of Jaén, Córdoba, and Seville. Several aims have been argued as a motivation for the royal decision to renew the Hispanic race, to repopulate extensive, deserted, and unproductive areas and make them economically profitable, to make safer the stretch of road which at the time was subject to the endemic assault of highwaymen, to compete with other successful repopulating European enterprises at the time in Russia and in Germany, in Prussia, under the common influence of cameralism in Prussia. Probably all these reasons were, to a greater or lesser extent, taken into consideration by the king and his counselors. A fifth reason, however, is never absent from the studies on the question. The realization, the fulfillment of the enlightened reformist ideal of the period. There were a lot of important enlightened statesmen involved in this project. But the best known of all are Pedro Pablo Abarca de Bolea, Count of Aranda and President of the Council of Castile, Pedro Rodríguez Campomanes, Minister of Finance, Miguel de Múzquiz y Goyeneche, Secretary of the Treasury and Supervisor of Alavides Project, José Moñino y Redondo, Count of Florida Blanca and Fiscal of the Council of Castile, and above all the aforesaid Pablo Antonio José de Olavide y Jauregui. There you have. This is the Count of Aranda, and this is Pablo Antonio de Olavide, who was created the first superintendent of the new statesmen. So all the weight of the creation of the practical things came upon his shoulder. There has been a lot of discussion, which still is going on whether the project was either reformist or utopist. Undoubtedly, both instances converge, since the enlightened elites of the 18th century were, for the most part, reformists. But we must take into account that they have assimilated a long tradition of utopist thought, starting with Thomas More, of course, but including other developments such as the other utopist, Campanella, for instance, or basically in Spain, Campanella, because Bacon didn't come to Spain. But other developments, not strictly not fictional, like for instance, physiocracy or the above mentioned cameralism, German cameralism, and of course the very movement of enlightened absolutism, which, owing a lot to the utopist tradition, had developed into the actual measure of social change. In this respect, it is difficult to distinguish how many of the parallelisms which we can find in the materialization of the enlightened project of the new settlements come straight away from More or are mediated through these later developments. We know that Olavide, Aranda, Campomanes, Florida Blanca, Jovellanos, all those statements that I have mentioned, were well versed in modern and progressive culture thanks to their private readings, travel abroad to France mainly, international relationships, coteries, both in Madrid and Seville, in the case of the Olavide, even in La Carolina, and libraries. They also read the best of the enlightened European philosophers and essays without renouncing to the Spanish ones. We know as well that they have the habit of sharing the books and their libraries, of their libraries. Olavide himself created a large one in Seville, out of which he intended to form a public library. Campomanes possessed also a large library. Both libraries contain an issue of the utopia. Thus it is not conceivable that they did not have knowledge of the book, especially if we keep in mind that this one of the scarce English words which had been translated into Spanish in the 17th century. Well, however, when we come to deal with the issue of More's influence on the Spanish enlightened elite, there is always an unavoidable intermediary reference, Sinapia. Or, as the full title runs, Description of la Sinapia, Peninsula en la Tierra Austral. That is the description of Sinapia, Peninsula in the Austral land. Okay? This utopic narrative was discovered by chance in 1975 in the collection of the archive of Pedro Rodriguez Campomanes, the Count of Campomanes, preserved in the foundation of the Universidad Española. It has been defined by Álvarez de Miranda, the most important known Spanish utopia, and in similar terms also by Avilés Fernández, by Ramón Tosol, and several others. It has been attributed to Campomanes himself, although there are doubts as to whether it was composed during the 18th or the 17th centuries, at the end of the 17th century. According to López Estrada, it follows the steps of Moore's utopia. Thus, it described the composition of a society characterized for being set up on a territory regularly structured in nine homogeneous square. Well, there is another, which divide in turn in another 49 minor squares. I want to mention that, unfortunately, there is an edition by Avilés, which is in the internet. There you have the directions, so you can read it if you can read Spanish. But actually, there are two publications in print, and this publication, which is accessible in Google Books, so in case you are interested. It basically, just to give a brief account, it's a society whose basic cell is family as a starting point for any other higher structure, from the quarters through the village and up to the town or metropolis on whose top the prince is situated. In this society, useful work was the norm, and the main dedication was agriculture, side by side with other economic activities such as cattle rearing and manufacturing, accomplishing in the way in this way a self-sufficient society. The parallelisms with Thomas More's utopia are evident. It is the product of the innovation of a foreign sailor, of a foreigner, the Dutch Abel Tasman, where references, and then there are very clear references. First of all, we can say that there are references to historical sailors, Spanish sailors, like Álvaro de Mendaña or Pedro Fernández de Quiroga, but also the Dutch Abel Tasman, and then Pedro de Nuts, Van Diemen's, more important, the narrator at the very beginning says that it was a text that has come to his hand by chance in a French translation of a Dutch original. So this really connects with what Lion mentioned the other day. This is why I was talking about connection, because possibly may be a connection there with the text you discussed. So another interesting thing is that it makes similar to that Sinapia is an acronym for Hispania, as you can see. And it is even mentioned that in earlier times it was called Birea, which obviously is Iberia, you know. So, and another interesting thing is that there is given the coordinates. So, this is 40 degrees latitude and 190 degrees longitude, Austral. Okay, so it could be really, in this respect, it's important. Well, Miguel Ángel Fernández and María Amparo López Arandia have spotted the main similitudes between Sinapia, I have added some others, and the new settlements by comparing the former with the latter's urban and territorial planning, the historical reality of the new settlements, and the founding charter, the founding charter of these communities, the so-called Fuero de las Nuevas Poblaciones de Sierra Morena y Andalucía. It was given by Charles III and contained a series of the rights which the natives and the immigrants were entitled to. It was bestowed by the king. Well, before entering the question of the main similitudes between the design of the new settlements and Utopia, whether mediated or not by Sinapia, we should have to underline the outstanding differences, because not all are similarities.
There is, for instance, nothing of proto-communism in the work of the new settlements. Consider that I am not comparing only Sinapia with Utopia, but Utopia, Sinapia, and the new settlements, okay? So, and especially, but not only, through the Fuero de las Nuevas Poblaciones, the charter of the new settlements. So, there is nothing of proto-communism. Indeed, as it has been repeatedly pointed out, the apparent proto-communism, which many seem to find in Utopia, are indeed defeated by the final conclusion of the narrator. Well, I mentioned that the Utopia is not a proto-communist, as some author, Kalski, for instance, have seen in the 1970s. Thus, although the protection and leading hand of the authorities and prince are evident in the project of the new settlements, it was meant and became in the end a private undertaking thought to develop at the hands of the private initiative of the colonists. So I think it was a social democrat kind of project because it was supported by the state, but it was the private initiative of the colonists. While there is a lot of communitarianism as well, both in Utopia and Sinapia, this communitarianism still existing in the repopulating project of the new settlements was much tempered by practical reasons. There is also provision to avoid excessive accumulation of lands in a few hands, as we will see. Another difference is that by Utopia, rather contradictorily with the biography and the rest of the world of Thomas More, portrays apparent society and freedom of religion. I mean, in Sinapia and in the new settlements, in the Fuero, religious conformity to the Catholic faith is a must, or was a must. In this sense, it is interesting to compare the position between the Utopian and Sinapia. I mean, the immigrants that were accepted should be Catholic, first of all. So, there were some sad cases of Protestants that came from Central Europe, as you will see, and then they have to convert into Catholicism or go back again to their places. Well, both in Sinapia and the new settlements are mixed. We can even talk of a miscellaneous, in a way, population is the demographic base of their society. This is tangentially interesting since it shows perhaps the general Spanish Empire attitude towards its subjects. It could perfectly tolerate ethnic diversity, but not religious. Difference. I have to mention that the immigrants, there is a long story about that, were basically Germans, Swiss, Flemish. At the very beginning, they didn't want to accept anybody from at the beginning from Spain, not for any other reason, but because they didn't want to depopulate areas of Spain to populate that. A German privateer was hired to bring Germans here, and then he was paid 326 reales for each immigrant that he brought here. Gaspar de Turigel was the name of this man, you know? So, well, in the end, they also have to bring Catalans and Valencians and people from the north because they were the most populated areas as well, you know? So, the main similitudes, however, found in these two scholars, this is the differences that you can see there, no? So, and then there is a long list. You can just have while I am revising it very briefly. So, there is social organization, education, school attendance is compulsory in the Fuero. The school attendance was compulsory as well, for boys only. As education also, the second one is as, I am not going to make reference to Utopia because I suppose it is well known what Thomas More says about education and all the main issues there. So, insisting again on education, structure is subordinated to the most important concern of farming. The Fuero of the New Settlement states that the boys only will attend classes in primary school in order to receive instruction in Catholic doctrine and Spanish. The accent of grammar and higher education was expressly indicated, since the main aim of the colonies was the practice of farming, cattle rearing, and manufacturing activities. The same happens really in Sinapia. Then another aspect would be social organization, family. The family unit is considered as the base of the society. It is today that the plot of land to be labored is delivered, and they were given corn, vegetable, instruments, and all those things. And the same more or less now that happens in Utopia, where the people are provided with the instrument, and more so in this case in Sinapia, where there is a similar organization. I mean, there are people organized around the what they call the pater familias, and then there are several pater familias, pater familias, working or labor pater familias, and all that. It reminds of the Utopia as well, in several. And because indeed, in Utopia, I remember that Morse mentioned that the people consider their, I don't remember the name, it's a Greek name for that, but the representative as a father, which is so another interesting thing is the demography. There is ethnic diversity both in Sinapia and in the in the foundations of the new statements. But as I say, the foundation, there were a mix import, which is even detected today in the existing of those, because you can fight together with Sanchez or Martinez, Mittelblum or Scherer or Neff or another popular one, for instance, Auffinger. So it's very common. So, but strangely enough, in Sinapia, the weight of foreign population in the social structure is very important and with a wider diversity. The inhabitants of Sinapia are Malaysians, Peruvians, Chinese, and Persians. And then they have constructed a very harmonious and successful society. I don't want to stand in that, you can ask me questions later, but the interesting thing is that the first inhabitants were a kind of the black people, Negroes, that they were displaced, but not entirely. And there is also another point that I have left. This is the map of Sinapia according to how it was described, So, an interesting thing is that the people, is like the Iberian Peninsula, but inverted. So, yes, but I don't know if you can see the, yes, but even the people surrounding them are for Lagos, which stands for Galos, so, and the other are Meganos, which are supposed to be Germans as well. Meganos, Germans, so this is Germanos in Spanish. So this is another interesting thing there. Well, there is also a social economical organization and labor. Basically, I'm going, they are especially interested in the utopias with useful citizens. Useful citizens and not idle occupations. So that they rejected, for instance, barbers. They didn't want to have barbers or musicians or people. They wanted to have, farmers and people who had a definite office, artisans as well, they were welcome. Basically, the weight of use of work is a frequent motto in the justification of the promotion of the new settlements in Sierra Morena and in Sinapia as well. So, the preeminence of agriculture, the agriculture is the base, in this sense, it is physiocratic as well. Is the base on which all the rest of the economy should be depend. Okay, another interesting thing. It should be complemented as well with stock breeding, and then they. The colonies were given, a cow to goats as well, some hens, so that they were provided just to. Another interesting thing is also that they ruled out, they eliminated the something which was a problem in Spain, which was the primogeniture and the main mort. So that from the, another interesting thing is that many of the tools and the media, the mediums used there were taken from the expulsion of the Jesuits and even in the land. So that the expulsion of the Jesuits at the time helped the construction of the new settlements. So, as I say, that the economic organization with the so pagans, I mean artisans, were also another interesting thing as well that happens is that women were especially thought to devote their free time to manufacturing wool, you know, and textiles, which is also another parallelism with both. And considering the political organization, there was a political representation, democratic representation. The authorities who ruled each town council are for a mayor, a deputy, a personero, kind of a spokesman, and a párroco, which was a priest. In Sinapia, more or less, it is the same. And in Utopia, I can refer to page 54, 55 of Turner's edition. There is also the mention of the representatives and how they are chosen and all these things. There was evidently provision for the existing of elective representative points in the new settlements with the aim in mind to avoid that the members of the council may perpetuate themselves in the public office. There was visitadores, that is, auditors, to control and supervise the correct compliance with the principle of the fuero. And in Sinapia, more or less in the same, and page 54 and 55 of Utopia insists on that as well. As to religion, the only difference is that the only religion there is Catholic religion. But there is a similarity because they insisted, it was something very modern, that the ceremony should be conducted in the vernacular. There was another interesting thing is that, this is what the immigrants were given, they were 50 fanegas of land, this is 32 hectares, or 200, the translation into quadrat metals, so that they really, and they were forbidden to sell for two or three generations, so you cannot. The result of that is that in those areas now there is no large proprietor. I mean, there is no what we call latifundismo. So another interesting thing is that there is also a kind of radial organization of the villages and the peregrinias or parishes, as they call that, and then the capital. So you have there how more or less it is organized. That in actual practice is not so evident. But you can see there that La Carolina, for example, Santa Elena are taking as example. The idea is that each independent village should not be removed more than 1.5 kilometers. Actually, it is 3 or 3.5 kilometers. The idea is that you could see one town from the other town as a defensive measure. I mean, really, the urbanism is a very important part in which. There was also a similar urban conception of farmhouses, something which was an anachronism perhaps, but still, this was, for instance, the way in which the schema that we have presented, La Villa, and the organization of the. And this has to do with the walled town. Even if there was no walls, but there are towers, there are two squares which were the entrance, you know, the gates to the city. This is it is called the Duen square at the time. So houses were all the same. at the beginning with two stories and all those things, which is also something that may. And then this is something that will start you if you go to any of those new populations. The streets are very wide, which reminds me of the utopia when they say the front of the houses are separated by a 20-foot carriageway. You know. Another interesting thing, just to finish, is that the civil and the religious power should be together. So this is what you have there: the church. Sorry. The church and then the Palacio del Superintendente or Superintendente Olavide, which is there. And then the plant, of course. It was geometrical, it was square, more or less, you know. But then you can see how the church and the palace was there, dominating all the city. It is there, you know. And then everything is divided in quarters. Let's see. Well, all the houses, as I say, each other the same. What we can do, there is another planning there. You can see an actual view of La Carolina, for example, so you can see that it is very square in all the. And another final thing is the importance of Garden. Charles III and Olavide were very interested in having, indeed, there were places that are called Los Jardinillos, and also orchards. There were a lot of orchards there at the time. So. He even brought people to instruct the immigrants in Latin, which reminds also of the utopia, as you can see there as well. This is, for instance, more or less something that reminds the way in which the quarters were conceived. Not exactly, but then you can see that there was a fountain and all this was garden. And indeed, well, those are the. There are more similarities. One, for instance, I have think of is that also in the Fuero have only 100, I think, and two articles, because they put special emphasis in that it should be clear and brief, you know? And then they also advocated for, so, but to conclude, we can say that in view of the proof presented above, some of them perhaps are quite far-fetched or tenuous. It is appropriate to wonder about the kind and nature of the presence of Moore's utopia in the founding text and practical implementation of the new settlements in Sierra Morena and Andalusia. It is out of doubt that the influence there was indeed. It is also out of doubt that much of the influence of utopia is filtered out through Sinapia. It is even tempting to imagine that Sinapia was written by Campomanes himself or somebody of his circle of friends and acquaintance. But beyond the details of any photographic, eidetic presence or textual presence of the text of Utopia, there is a deeper and more consequential process for what we could call the phylogenesis. And this is what I am interested in, of the Utopia. Rooted deeply in the Christian message of egalitarianism and mutual love and the apostolic communitarianism, it would undergo a first sea change, to mention Shakespeare, at the heart of the Christian humanist Thomas More, who coined the word utopia, rather ambiguously. Half in earnest, I think, and half in jest. It made its fortune in the political and cultural development of Europe later, to the point to be taken seriously and given rise to a change of meaning, so that the word, at least I think that, that the word have enjoyed a certain good repute, I think. That perhaps not the same as the original word with Morse today, because to be utopian, so the utopia, to dream of utopia is a good thing, I think. To do with is not exactly illusoriness for the most part. It finally entered political and culture, political and culture. With utopias, dystopias, uchronias, real-life utopias, like for instance the hippies' experiments, either social or political as well, and have since played an important role in the chessboard of Western culture and politics. The Enlightenment, to me, occupies a critical place in this development. It is the crossroad in which the fantastical ideas of Christian utopies, such as More himself, Bacon or Campanella, began to take shape in real-life experiments of a political nature, in line with the idea of enlightened absolutism, It is also interesting to compare that there is always a prince, an authority in all the utopias, for the working for the well-being of the people, without the people, to pour le peuple, rien par le peuple. Well, utopia and reform converge. This is why it is so difficult to separate both intentions, not only in the experiments of the new settlements, but in many other European enlightened endeavors. As it has been previously, it has previously happened with the Reformation, soon the forces of radicalism pushed strongly in the direction of the revolution, and what was the Christian and naive became, what was Christian and naive became secular and hard-headed after the French Revolution. It is against this background that we may understand the influence of Moore's utopia in enlightened men like Olavide or Campomanes, Moore's utopia has become part of the cultural horizon of these men and fused with their lives and thought more or less unconsciously and consequentially with that cultural horizon.
That's my interpretation.